said, greet the person next to you.
I believe in the sun. I believe in the risen one. I believe I overcome by the power of his blood. Amen. Amen. I'm alive. I'm alive because he lives. Amen. Amen. Let my song join the one that never ends because he covered in sin and shame. I heard mercy call my name. He rolled the stone away. Amen. Amen. I'm alive. I'm alive because he
his home. And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing your praise unending.
You called me into the light. You called my name and then
welcome back, and still talking about these little reels in life. I don't know about you, but some of them are so funny, some of them are sad, some of them teach you a lot of different things. I've been thinking a lot about these amazing TikTok guys in the Bible, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Y'all know them. They tell us these little snippets about Jesus' life. And those snippets, as we read them, continue to make a profound impact on our life. And we're going to be looking together with another one of those this morning. I want you all to know this. Jesus did not set out to impress people. He didn't want likes. No, he wanted followers. I think of virtue signaling this morning when we think about social media. And virtue signaling, the actual definition of that, or or in my words, would be this is where people post things saying that they are right, morally right, or that they got this thing of life called this thing called life figured out. In a sense, they're saying, look at me. But Jesus, as our base this morning, is saying, look to the Father. And he's always there to glorify the Father. And he is, him and the Father are one. Amen. As a leader, the big idea this morning, as a leader, Jesus served with a purpose, not for the views. If you got your Bibles, open up to John chapter 13, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. My dad used to tell my sister to make sure and carry the Bible in her car between her and her date, so if they wanted to get together, the date had to climb over Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. But John always be the last one. It was kind of like he was filling in all the spots. He had heard a lot of the same stories in the other Gospels, and so it's like he was filling in the blank places in between the different reels, making other reels, so it kind of put the whole story together. And we're going to look here with John in John chapter 13, verses 4 through 8, a very intriguing reel, one that happened right before Jesus was arrested, right before he was betrayed, before he was nailed to the cross, before he rose again. Right there in that little section of time, he's in the upper room with his disciples. They're having the Last Supper, and this happens. John 13, 4 through 8. So he got up from the meal, he took off his outer clothing, and he wrapped it around his waist. Now, in those days, they had a lower garment. They had an upper garment that kind of went from your neck down to your knees. And then they had an outer garment that a teacher would wrap around himself. Now, a servant normally wouldn't have all these extra clothes. They might just have the one that goes, the undergarment, that would go from the neck down to the knees. And this was an important thing. He took off his outer garment because he's getting ready to do some work. I don't know about you, but it's hot outside right now, right? Like, we went to the base and did Praise the Base this weekend. I took an extra shirt with me because I knew I was going to sweat. If I walk outside in Missouri in August, I'm going to sweat. Somebody say amen. And Jesus, though, he's getting ready to do some work. He's prepared for work. He takes off this outer garment, he wraps a towel around his waist, and after he had poured water into a basin, he began to wash the disciples' feet, drying them with a towel that was wrapped around him. Now, in this day, this was a big deal. You know, people's feet got nasty. They had Air Jordans, you know. They had the Jesus Jordans, the sandals that they would put on, and their feet would get dirty. If they had sandals, whenever they would come to eat, people didn't sit around a table like you and I do. They all reclined at the table. They laid down. So oftentimes, dirty, smelly feet, you know, nobody wants that up at the table. In those days, they would usually have the lowest servant in the house would wash the guest's feet. This was a customary practice. But nobody actually had done that at this dinner yet. And so Jesus begins to do that. He came to see, he poured water in a basin to wash his disciples' feet, and he dried them with a towel that was wrapped around him. Verse 6, he came to Simon Peter, who said to him, Lord, are you going to wash my feet? And Jesus replied, you do not realize now what I'm doing, but later you will understand. No, said Peter, you shall never wash my feet. And Jesus answered, unless I wash you, you have no part with me. Boy, isn't it cool how we see the gospel in that one sentence? Unless I wash you, you have no part with me. You remember as we think about John chapter 14 when he says in verse 6 that he is the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father but by him. Unless we allow him to cleanse us from our sin, the Bible says in 1 John 1, 9 that if we confess our sins, Jesus is just and faithful and will forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And here he's telling Peter in a simple phrase that, you know, he's got a towel around his waist, he's got a wash basin at the bottom of his feet, he's getting ready to wash his feet. And Peter says, you're not the servant, I should serve you, basically. There's no way you're serving me. And Jesus says, if you don't allow me to do this, you can have no part of me. What he's saying is you can't get to heaven on your own. You can't have eternal life on your own. You have to allow me to serve you, to die for you, to do. So this question, this thing, this conversation is going on. The setting at the table is simple. Jesus is saying in a few days, it's all going to be done. I'm going to get arrested. Somebody at this table is going to betray me. He's having this big conversation. In Luke 22, 24, he says, a dispute also arose among them as to which of them was considered to be the greatest. So right before Jesus kneels down to wash their feet, they're here and Jesus is talking about his kingdom and it's coming and all the things are about finished and these different things are going to happen. And in their mind, they're thinking he's come to rule, to set them free from captivity from the Romans, to not have be under their governing rule, there's going to be a whole new order of things, and Jesus is going to reign. And so the disciples begin to ask, who's the greatest among us? And Jesus says the greatest in Luke, right there, among you, will be the least. He will, in fact, be a servant of all. And right after that, now John's filling in the gap because Luke doesn't talk about it, but Jesus takes off his robe and he begins to wash his disciples' feet. You and I have been talking about these reels and what we can do, and as we finish up this series, we are called to be leaders and influencers in our world. And if we're going to lead like Jesus, we got to do it, here's the first thing, by humbling yourself. Humbling yourself. Man, I'm going to tell you, some of the greatest leaders I've ever met in my life are those that humble themselves. I learned a long time ago that a need seen is an assignment given. If I see a piece of paper on the floor, I don't need to go find the custodian. I need to pick it up and throw it away myself. If I see someone in need, I don't need to go tell somebody else that that person's in need. God's actually reflected that in my heart because I'm a part of the body of Christ. And if there's anything that I can do personally to help that person, a need seen is an assignment given. I didn't learn this on my own. I watched my dad do it. I watched him give over and over again, being a pastor throughout her entire life. You know that he served other people. I have a good friend. You all know him, Frank Whitney. He'll actually be here tomorrow night. You all don't miss it. Tomorrow night we're going to have some singing and some comedy. He's going to tell stories from church life that will just rock your socks. Like the time when a lady come up and said, you know, we don't like facial hair. You know, goatee going on. And he told her, shave your eyebrows off, sister. Be consistent. There's just things that we're not supposed to say that sometimes come out. Yeah, he'll be here, I think, 6:30 tomorrow night. So we'd love to have all y'all come out. But Frank, what a servant. I've watched him. I don't know of anybody that could outdo this guy when it come to making hospital visits. When it come to, I mean, not only can he preach in the pulpit, but this guy, he's a servant first. I mean, he will mow your yard. He's got a little bad back now, but probably because of all these things. And I've told him still to this day, Frank, I call him Franco. I say, Franco, I don't know if I'll ever be able to keep up or match the intensity of the servanthood that you've modeled for me. This humble, taking on this humble, this picture of a humble servant, Jesus is taking on this humbleness. Here's what it says in Philippians chapter 2, verse 8. And being found in the appearance of a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on the cross. This humility that Jesus took, he's all God, yet he's all man. He's limited himself by coming into a bodily form and taking on that punishment and even dying on a cross, an agonizing death, so that you and I could be saved. He didn't have to do that. He didn't have to be established. He's already God. We don't have to try to have a dispute over that. No, he just is. I wanted to throw up a few different definitions of humility this morning. Here's the first one. Humility is understanding one's talents and accomplishments while accepting one's imperfections. I mean, we got to know our limitations, don't we? It's okay that, you know, that we don't have everything that someone else has when it comes to our personality and who we are and what we look like. It's really okay. Here's another one. To be humble is not to have a low opinion of oneself. It's to have an accurate opinion of oneself. You ever heard somebody say, "Boy, that person, Sister Sarah, she's a humble person." I mean, and you listen to Sister Sarah, and Sister Sarah always is saying, "Listen, I'm no good. There's no good in me." Listen, I'm gonna tell you something. You are a child of God. Being humble doesn't mean you don't recognize who you are in Jesus. It's not about making yourself, it's not about tearing yourself down or tearing yourself up or making yourself seem worse. Listen, we already know we're all sinners. We've all fallen short of the glory of God. We already know there's only one perfect person on the planet, and that was Jesus, because he's God. Here's the last one, humility. I like this one. This is the one that I would say this is for us. Humility is not thinking less of yourself, but rather it's thinking of yourself less. This is the picture of Jesus. The Bible said in Luke chapter 14, Jesus came to seek and to save that which was lost. Jesus has always had you and me on his mind. The Bible says he knew us before the foundation of the earth. Why? He created you. He knows you better than you know you. Our main text this morning in John 13, 4 through 5, so he got up from the meal, he took off his outer clothing, he wrapped it around his waist, and after he'd poured water into the basin, he began to wash the disciples' feet, drying them with a towel that was wrapped around him. If we're going to lead like Jesus, we're going to have to humble ourselves like Jesus. This picture that we see of a humble servant is who God's called us to be. Second thing is serving others. If we're going to lead like Jesus, we got to serve others. Matthew chapter 14. This is right before he fed the 5,000 people. When Jesus landed and he saw a large crowd, he had compassion on them and he healed their sick. It says that he had compassion on them. He saw them right where there was, saw their needs, and he began to meet their needs, not only by healing the sick, but that story does go on, and it talks about how there were all these people around, and we talked about it a few weeks ago, how he looked at them and he said, you know, "Hey, where are we going to get some, where's the local Long John Silver's at?" Y'all remember? "Hey, where can we get enough bread for all these people to eat?" And the disciples said, "Man, it's going to take over a year's wages." Philip said, just to feed these people. But Andrew says, "Hey, there's a little boy over here. He says he's got 2 fish and 5 loaves of bread. Jesus said, "Bring him over here." So the little boy gave his food up that I'm sure his mama packed for him. And Jesus began to pray over and he broke the bread and the fish and he began to distribute it. The disciples, and they began to distribute it. There was 12 baskets left over. Everybody had all they needed. They had their fill, the Bible says. This servanthood. I haven't got a chance to go on a cruise ship. Maybe you have. But I've talked to a lot of people that's gone on cruise ships. Boy, I'd like to go sometime. I heard that when you go on a Disney cruise, in particular, that when you go on a Disney cruise, I heard that you don't even have to carry your bags on. Like, at the airport, when you check your bags, that's it. And then when you get to your room on the cruise, your bags are already in your room. How do they know that? That's amazing. I hear that man, it is all about the passenger. That anything they can do to meet your need and accommodate you, they're doing everything they can to make your experience while you're on board the ship the best experience ever. That the whole crew is involved in making your experience amazing. reminds me of a church. This is your first time today. We hope that your experience is amazing. I tell everybody, if you come once, you're a guest. If you come twice, you're a part of us. You're a part of the crew at that point. You're not just a cog in a wheel. You're not just filling in a space or a tool. You're not just a tool to make the whole thing happen, to make this dream. No, we're a part. We're significant in the kingdom of God, and everyone matters, but you matter when you become a servant leader like Jesus called you to be, that you take ownership on what he's given you. It's as if the ship belongs to you. See, passengers matter. The crew matters. You know, some churches you go and you become a part of the crew and it just feels like you don't matter anymore, only the guest. Boy, I pray that doesn't happen here. I pray that you realize that you see, that you hear from us, that you matter in the body of Christ. You know, I think about those that get it. John 13:14, Jesus says, "Now that I, your Lord and your teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet." You ever had a conversation with a group of people and you just feel like some people in your small group, some people in your church, some people in your club, they just get whatever it is, they get it. Like they want to be a part of it and they understand that they're a part of it and that what they say is a reflection on the whole and how they act is a reflection on the whole. And they're just willing to do anything and everything. They are 100%ers, I call them. They're not 98% of the time. They're 100% of the time. If they have to miss one weekend, they feel like they missed out on something. They're 100%ers. You know what makes LifePoint so great? It's all you 100%ers. That's what makes it great. Here's the next thing for you. If we're going to be leaders like Jesus wants us to be leaders in our world today, we got to model the way. We got to model it. We got to show someone else what God has been doing in us. Jesus said, "Follow me." Jesus told his disciples, "Follow me." You know, he told them that 43 times in the New Testament, "Follow me. Do what I do. Walk like I walk. Talk like I talk. Do what I do." In other words, do what the Father leads us to do. John 13:12-17, if you go a little further down there in our text, "When he had finished washing their feet, he put on his clothes and he returned to his place. He says to them this question, 'Do you understand what I have done for you? You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am. Now that I, your Lord and your teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet.' And then he says it like this, 'I have set you an example that you should do as I done for you.'" Go to the next slide. "Truly I tell you, no servant is greater than his master, nor is a master greater than the one who sent him. Now that you know these things, you will be blessed if you do them." You want to experience God's blessing in your life? Then we have to be like Jesus and serve one another. It's more blessed to give than to receive. Somebody say hallelujah. Boy, isn't it fun? This year, I had them add up, and benevolently this year, just since January, and here we are in August, the year is not over, we've already done almost, it's $78,000 in benevolence. Somebody say hallelujah. That is you serving our community. That is amazing to me. I'm blown away. And that doesn't count whenever we have different ones that go and do acts of service beyond financial needs, where we just go and we help somebody that is in need. And man, I want to tell you, God is doing that in our world globally through you 100%ers. We got to model it. When I went to be a youth pastor of my second church, it was Calvary Baptist Church in Odessa. And I'll never forget, they brought Angie and I on staff there. And the first week I was in church, I had a young family that their daughter and their son-in-law only been married a week. Or, well, they've been married a little bit longer than that. I'm sorry, he'd only been a Christian a week. Probably only been married a few months. She had gotten pregnant outside of wedlock. This is still back in the day. I mean, it's been 20 plus years ago. That was a very unpopular thing. Y'all following me? Man, the church just loved on him. Gary came from a background. His family grew up Catholic, but they never went to a Catholic church. I love it when people, listen, it's not just Catholics like that. We got Baptists like that. We got Methodists like that. We got Lutherans like that. They say, yeah, I go to the whatever church, and you haven't seen them in church in like 15 years. They don't go to that church. The preacher don't even know their name. And by the way, just going to church doesn't make somebody a Christian. There's a lot of people go to church today that they don't know Jesus. It's just to some people, it's a religious activity. It's what I'm supposed to do, so I go. It's not because of a relationship where I feel the presence of God in my life. I feel the conviction of God. And man, I want to meet Him again. I want to encounter Him again. And that's why I go. But Gary was a new Christian. He didn't know nothing, man. They didn't even go to Sunday school. But me and Gary had something in common. We both liked fishing, and we were both relatively pretty young back then. And so even though he worked as, he was a guy that he did flat work, concrete work, and they would get up early in the summertime, but we would stay up. Sometimes I don't even think he went to bed because we'd stay up 4 o'clock in the morning fishing. But we started fishing together, and then I was convinced, man, we didn't catch very many fish. I told him, I'm like, I thought you were a good fisherman. And then I found out later, he put a little New Testament in his tackle box because he had questions that he needed answers to. Gary never heard until I told him about David and Goliath. He'd never heard about Daniel in the lion's den. He'd never heard the story of Esther. He'd never, and maybe I'm naming off some of these, and you're here sitting going, I never heard that either. Listen, man, there's some fantastic reels inside of our Bible that are still impacting our lives today that change the way we think and who we are and how we are motivated in our understanding. What I realized is that Gary needed someone to model the way. He was watching my life. I had no idea the impact that it was going to have. Did you know Gary Van Lanker today is the pastor of Quarter Baptist Church over by Lexington? It is so cool to watch how God has moved in his life in such a way that God used him to win his sister, his brother, his other brother, his mom and his dad, all to Jesus, who are all professing Christians today. It is amazing to me. I have set you an example, Jesus said, that you should do as I've done for you. Listen, I like people to like me. It really bothers me when people don't like me. Maybe you're like that. I don't know why anybody wouldn't like me. I'm a pretty nice dude. And if you show up at lunch, I'm buying your lunch. I mean, it's the way it is. So it really bothers me when someone doesn't like me. But Jesus has called us not to be going after the likes, but to go and make disciples, that's followers of Jesus. Let me ask you this question. What's your next step? Will you make a profound impact on someone else's life by humbly serving them, modeling for them the love and the grace of Jesus Christ? Will you walk beside them? That's the next step, that we would turn our life over to Jesus completely, that we would not be a 98 or a 95%, or that we'd be a 100%, and that we would see ourselves, even though we're on the crew, that the guest is important. Listen, you and I, sometimes I'm talking to people, and I never mean to be rude, okay? But all of you know that my business card is out front. That doesn't have a church number on it. That has my cell phone number on it. Because I want you to always have access to call me and talk to me. And I will talk to you for hours. But that guest, if I walk away from you in the lobby to go say goodbye to a guest, that may be the only time that I ever get to speak to that person ever. We get one chance, oftentimes, to share the love of Jesus. Folks, I want to tell you something. I ain't ignoring you, and you're not less important than a guest. But I pray that we all take on the attitude of Christ, of servants, of servants. You know, we've got many ways that you can serve at LifePoint. There's small groups, first of all. We want you to come get involved in those. We have Connect, Grow, and Go. And the connection is right here in worship. But our Grow part happens in small groups. And if you haven't got a small group yet, the tags are out there on that front window as you leave. Listen, if you want to start a small group, it's not too late. We don't actually get rolling until second week of September, and even then it's not too late. We want to show you how. We actually have our training on a thumb drive now that you can take home, watch on your computer, and it'll show you how to be a small group host. We really want you to get involved through serving or going. And that happens through some of our different ministries. Maybe you're like, I can sing. We want you to talk to Bobby. Maybe some of you say, man, I could be a greeter. I mean, I could put a smile on my face at 7 a.m. Some people can't, believe me. It's just harder for some, right? But you could be a greeter. Maybe you could be one of those people. Listen, our children's ministry is growing like wildfire. Our fourth and fifth grade has doubled in the last 2 months. We've been having 85, 90 students, second, third service. Folks, I'm going to tell you something. We don't just need you. You're not a cog in the wheel. My prayer is that you would say, man, I have a knack. I can go and help serve our students that are coming in, those little people that we know God is having an impact in their life. And maybe like Gary, one day they wake up and they say to you, you made a difference, a profound difference in my life for the kingdom of God. Listen to me, they're watching us and they will model after you. They will model after you. Grab Hillary on your way out today. You say, what do I got to do to help out with kids? Well, the biggest thing is we do a background check. I think everybody should know that. Praise the Lord. Aren't you glad if you got kids back there that we do a background check? Hallelujah. That's really the biggest thing. And then we teach you step by step the different jobs, the different things, the different ministry aspects of kids ministry or youth ministry. Listen, we have youth ministry starting September the 11th on Sunday nights. Last year we maxed out at 40. This year I expect us to be 70, 80. We need adults, you know. Teenagers left to themselves is not a good thing. Y'all with me? It's going to be fun. But God has a place for you to serve. Just got to go to what we call Praise the Base. Many of us went over and praised with our airmen over there and got to be prayer warriors and that kind of thing this week. And you say, I want to do stuff like that. We want you to. September, we're coming up. We're going to be going to Puerto Rico, folks. I'm going to tell you something. I can't wait. It's like 7 degrees here. It's 87 degrees there in February. And we'll go suffer for Jesus together. Amen. Listen, we could be smart about it. God's called you. Follow Jesus. Model by serving others this morning. Lord, y'all stand with me. Lord, I love you. And God, I thank you for this day. I thank you for the opportunity we have to be in your house. God, I thank you for the reels that you share with us regularly. The reels that will change our life. God, I thank you how Jesus modeled for us to serve, to seek what was lost, to help model the way. God, help us lead in our world that way. Help us to humble ourselves and say, I won't make time for anything of God. I want to make time for it. God, I pray today for people to surrender to help with our kids ministry, with our youth ministry, with our cafe, God, with our greeting, with our hospitality. God, I just pray in every way, our music, our tech team. God, I'm so grateful for all those that already volunteer. And God, I pray today that they would know the impact that they're having on people's lives, whether here presently or even online. God, I pray that you'd guide us, direct us, and motivate us today. God, to be a part of the reels that you have coming up. And it's in your name we do pray. Amen. Would you come as God leads you right now? We want to pray with you. You come.
I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. The world behind me, the cross before me. The world behind me, the cross before me.
Folks, let me tell you something. Probably one of the most humbling things that we can do is not be ashamed if God's doing something in our life. Maybe you feel the Holy Spirit's drawing this morning. Maybe you don't. This talk is not about getting people to come forward. This talk is about giving you the opportunity to say yes to the drawing of the Holy Spirit. So if God's moving in you, humble yourself. Come forward. Let's pray together. Man, the Bible says in Matthew 10:32-33, that if you acknowledge me before men, I'll acknowledge you before my Father in heaven. But if you deny me before men, I'll deny you before my Father in heaven. This opportunity for you to make a decision. Nobody knows what decision you're making, nor do they need to worry about what decision you're making. But when you walk up here, it's like making it real between you and God. It's not just lip service that no one else can hold you accountable for. But are you willing to say, God, I've decided to follow you. I'm going to help out in kids ministry. I'm going to help out greeting people. I'm going to help out, you know, in any way I can, Lord, in your church. I'm going to help out any way I can at my work. I'm going to be a servant leader. I'm going to change the way that my workplace thinks about me. Because when they ask, what do you want to do? I just say, I want to serve people. You want to blow somebody's mind? Tell them that at work. How can I serve you? You want to blow your wife's mind, husband? How can I serve you? Wife, you want to blow your husband's mind? How can I serve you? It's a humble thing. Would you come? Third thing, come on.
Though none go with me, I still will follow. Thank you.
I'm with you, Scott. I just forget every now and then. Rusty pretty much covered everything I've got to say. I will fill in some dates and some blanks with some of that. The Connection Point class will be the 11th of September. And if you're new here and want to get to understand us and us to know you and understand you better, maybe answer some of your questions about our theology and so forth, we invite you to come to that. Just kind of register out there at the coffee shop. If those with taking offering, I always seem to forget this. We'll say a prayer over this offering. Heavenly Father, we're so grateful for this day, Lord, to come and fellowship with one another, Lord. We pray that you will guide us with this offering, Lord, so that we can serve our community, Lord, to help those who are in need and just to fulfill your wishes. In Jesus' name, amen. Now we'll get back here. The small groups, that's an opportunity, like Rusty said, to get to know one another, to study in the Word of God and the Gospel. It's just a good time to get together. And those are on the window out front. And like you said, you can join them anytime. But we're just trying to get the classes filled so everyone knows who's going to come. If you get one of those cards, the phone number's on there for the sponsor. Give them a call and see where they're at and get to know about their group. The Gals of Promise will meet September 1st at 9 a.m. in the coffee shop out here. Mary Boatwright Pace leads that group. And those gals do a lot of good things. It's something to be involved in. If it's your first time here, scan the QR code on the chair in front of you. If not, call 218-1202 and just greet us. And somebody get with you and greet you and welcome you to be a part of our congregation. So now I'm going to have a prayer and we'll be dismissed for the day. Father God, help us to go forth into our community, Lord, to take your word, the word of the gospel, Lord, to the lost. Help us to know, to see that moment that we need to touch someone. Lord, help us to pray with our loved ones, our family, our friends and neighbors. Just walk with us every day. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.